Where does the universe come from in the first place? Why is it here? What is the connection between maths and physics? These fundamental questions have occupied scientists and philosophers for centuries. Traditional physics searches for fundamental laws that describe how our universe behaves. But what if this is approaching it backwards? What if our universe is actually a mathematical function and the collection of physical laws are emergent effects? This is the 12th video in this series. Let's reiterate the objectives of this project and take stock of where we are and what is yet to be covered. We'll organize this video around three categories of questions. First, these fundamental questions are about reality itself. Second, the quantum phenomena that seem to defy common sense. And third, the challenges in developing a complete mathematical framework for this approach. For each question, we'll use a color code to show our progress. Green for conclusive answers, rare unfortunately. We aim at least for a blue. Plausible explanation, but lacking a definitive proof. After all, our objective is to present a different view from traditional physics to how the world could work. White is for questions we haven't addressed yet, and red for any fatal flaws in our reasoning, though hopefully we won't need that one. Most importantly, we'd like to hear from you, especially those in the professional physics community. What would convince you that this approach is worth consideration? What evidence would you like to see? Which other questions would you like to see answered in future videos? Let's start with these fundamental questions about reality itself. Where does the universe come from? Why is there something rather than nothing? This should at least be blue. In fact, I'm tempted to mark it as green. We've covered this in video 3, 6 ideas, but it's worth a recap, so let's talk about why our universe exists. What are the usual explanations? Discounting religious and mystical approaches, often the question is ignored. Some people assume it's unknown and unknowable. Others just claim that the world was created out of the Big Bang. You could hypothesize that we're living in a simulation, but that just shifts the question to why the simulator exists. A common attitude is to assume that our universe contains a number of things, like fundamental particles, or fields, or strings, which exist in a certain number of space and time dimensions, and which obey a collection of rules. Some of these rules are neat and succinct, and there is also a small set of universal constants with values that can only be empirically measured. This opens the door to an anthropic explanation to why the world is the way it is. We can postulate that every possible combination of laws, things, and constants exists. If only a small number of these allow a world with intelligent, conscious observers, then of course we must live in such a world. But the anthropic principle does not address the big question. Why are there things such as particles or fields in the first place? We can actually answer this if we accept one crucial assumption, that mathematics exists independently of physical reality, what philosophers call mathematical Platonism. Mathematics transcends physics. That is to say that maths is not just universal, but pan-universal. You can imagine many different universes with different rules of physics, but the natural numbers exist in each and independently of these universes. The natural numbers have an initial condition and a generating function. So, if the natural numbers exist, then so do other functions, and one of these generates our universe. You could say that the function is our universe. Unlike the natural numbers, this function is multidimensional, so it produces a multidimensional grid with an equally multidimensional value at each point, so you can look at it as a vector field. The value of each vector in the grid is calculated from the values of its predecessors, going all the way back to one initial value. It is the goal of this video series to present a concrete candidate for such a function. This explanation is not original. Pythagoras suspected 2,500 years ago that all things were made of numbers. In the 1960s, Konrad Zuse first proposed that the universe could be a giant cellular automaton, and there have been further developments with digital physics and cellular automata with work by Fredkin, Conway, Wolfram, and others. The problem with cellular automata is that they invite the question what they're running on. A mathematical set defined by the values of predecessors as described above is equivalent to a cellular automaton but doesn't need any hardware to run on. Next question. What's the connection between maths and physics? This follows directly from our previous answer. Physics isn't just described by mathematics, it is mathematics. This isn't just abstract philosophy. What we traditionally call particles are actually eddies in fields, and the fields themselves are multidimensional values in a multidimensional grid. Here's a bonus question. Why does the world follow the laws of physics? This we can also color green. The laws of physics are emergent effects, just as complex patterns emerge from simple mathematical rules in fractals or cellular automata. These answers might seem abstract, but they eventually lead to concrete testable predictions when we consider quantum phenomena, which brings us to our second list. Our second list addresses phenomena that seem to defy common sense in traditional physics, but they are nicely explained by the existence of multiple time dimensions. What is the role of the observer in quantum physics? This is a question that's often brushed under the carpet, but central to quantum physics. In our first video, we showed how multiple time dimensions naturally lead to multiple identical copies of observers sharing the same mind state. So the apparent superposition isn't in the environment, but the synchronized mind states of identical observer copies that diverge when differing information reaches them. What about uncertainty and superposition? These questions have been answered in several videos, including the first one about multiple time dimensions, and also in About Time, the seventh video. What is quantum tunneling? How does the quantum Zeno effect work? These have been covered in the second video about tunneling, but may be revisited in a future video. It's not the particles that move through barriers. Instead, the observer's mind states move between timelines where particles are in different states, for example, different positions. In my mind, the prediction of the quantum Zeno effect is a particularly strong indication that this interpretation is correct. It is very hard to make sense of otherwise. This is also mentioned in video 6, Emergence and Vision. Wave-particle duality, the speed of light, and also the aims of this project were first introduced in 6 ideas. Does the double slit experiment have a logical explanation? The 9th video is dedicated to answering this. A reason for the number of space dimensions is proposed in video 5, how many dimensions? Some other questions are still to be covered in future videos. For example, the hierarchy problem of force strengths, how to reconcile quantum physics and general relativity. We touched upon special relativity in video 7, about time, but this is worth its own video. Dark matter. You can see the mechanism for that in video 5, space-time structure, and video 6, emergence and vision. Please let me know if you want me to revisit this. In previous videos, we have glibly claimed that the wave function describes the state of the spaces sideways in time. We should revisit this with a bit more rigor. How does quantum entanglement work? What Einstein called spooky action at a distance isn't spooky at all in our framework. This has been explored in many videos, including the first. Notice that all these explanations share a common thread. They don't require us to abandon common sense or add arbitrary rules. They're natural consequences of having multiple time dimensions. Our third list are requirements for the generating function. When we propose that the universe is generated by a function, we need a number system to describe values and coordinates, a structure defining predecessors, an initial condition, and a generating formula. The number system we'll use has been comprehensively defined in video 4, Imaginary Numbers Reimagined. For the structure, we reuse the predecessor concept from the same number system as proposed in video 5, Space-Time Structure. The initial condition will get a couple of videos. Those haven't been done yet. The existence of a simple discrete generating function raises some more questions arising directly from the hypothesis. Absolute XYZ axes are not in evidence. Our function needs to demonstrate rotational invariance. We've defined a multidimensional number set, but each coordinate is an integer. We have not defined real numbers, not even fractions, not even general multiplication. Now, how can this represent our universe where we can seemingly measure some properties to arbitrary precision? Probabilities come in Gaussian distributions, electromagnetic waves travel as sine waves. How can we do this with integers? This video is still to come. Eventually, we'll get to the actual generating formula, simple enough to be fundamental, yet capable of generating all the emergent complexity we observe. It won't be recognizable for what it is until a few more preparatory videos lay the groundwork. To the viewers, especially in the physics community, what would convince you that this approach deserves consideration? What questions are missing from these lists? Please share your thoughts in the comments below. We'll revisit the updated lists in a future video. Thanks for watching.